A former student of mine is in the room, so he will maybe see some familiar things. I was teaching macroeconomics in Brussels for a few years, 4 or 5 years, and now I'm teaching in Antwerp. My main specialization as in my education was monetary economics, but I have diversified afterwards, but I still follow the field of monetary economics a bit more than a bit. And for me, as being said, my book Reckless is half about the monetary union and the failings, the why the setup of our monetary union cannot work and will not work and has to be adjusted. And what my concern mainly is that there is a pensée unique, that there is a dominant vision and everybody else who is thinking differently is wrong. And this is being told by central bankers, this is being told by university professors, and certainly in Europe, and maybe even more in Belgium, most people believe that you can't really argue about these issues, this is mathematics, axiomatic, and no big discussion possible. The reverse is true, and we need, mainly today, central banking is discussed in our media as an interest for investors, speculators. No, it's also an interest for citizens. And yes, there is an independence of the central bank, but it has also a mandate which it has to adhere to. So I'm pleading for more diversity of opinion and more room for debate. And so one of the statements which puzzled me the most from Mario Draghi was, at one point in time he said, we will do what we do, and we will not look at side effects. They are not mattering for us. This is, for me, irrational. The progress of the humankind is based on rational thinking, weighing costs and benefits, and saying we will not look at the side effects, the detriments of our policy, is something which you cannot just state like that. And so we have to do that in a serious manner. As being said, you can look at our website of our think tank, and we are occupying with a lot of Belgian reform debates, and you can look it up over there. If you look at what is being said and expected from central bankers today, they have to ensure price stability, they have to resolve balance sheet problems, banks with a lot of bad debt, they have to shape the yield curve, they have to deliver low employment. All that is not possible. It's an old statement of Jan Tinbergen, an old Nobel Prize winner. If you have two objectives, you need two instruments. The central bank doesn't have all the instruments available for achieving all these goals. And if you do that, this is what is really being in the field. The central bank has to do all that. Whereas the theory is, it is only to do the first thing, price stability. All the rest is not in the mandate of the central bank. And for instance, what did we have in the euro crisis was a big debate about problems with the debt of certain southern European countries. Well, let's debate about that in the democratic fora, meaning, Are we in favor of introducing a bond, European bonds, or not? That's about transferring money from people in one part of the Eurozone to other parts. That's not in the mandate of the central bank. So let's discuss that in a democratic way. And then what we see is that they don't achieve any consensus on that, and then they do it by the back door, and the back door is the central bank. Because now the actions of the central bank are about creating a euro bonds and about transferring losses and profits between people in the Eurozone. So that's the big issue. If you are talking about the mandate of the central bank, it's about big things. It's about, we have a democratic debate, we don't have a result in democratic debate, and then we do it nonetheless through the back door. That's not, and that's anti-democratic. I'm sorry. So central banks have to do all these things, and well, imbalances have been created. And for instance, all these forex exchange reserves of all these central banks are amassing, and well, Bernanke was the one who said, oh, this is creating huge problems of imbalances. This is still going on. That's also something you have to debate every time again. Oh, the financial crisis, that's 10 years on. No, the big imbalances which created the crisis in 2008 are still with us. So let's tackle the real problems. And the big debate is, by creating all that additional money, isn't that the way to avoid tackling the real problems? So that's the moral hazard issue. And that's a real political issue. That's not a technocratic issue. The central bank, through its actions, makes it possible that we don't tackle the real problems of our countries. And so it has pushed to the limit, because you can do that for some time, but now we have almost come to the limit. The one step beyond this is helicopter money, which you can read about on the website. So there are a lot of excesses and imbalances, but the truth, of course, is that a lot of people like it. A lot of people like to be on heroin. The users of heroin are very happy, and if you have debates in the media and all that, it's all about the investors. Of course, the short-visioned investors, and many of them are short-termish, well, they like that asset prices have been inflated like that. And then there is the issue that there is a wealth effect, as explained by Professor Stark in the US, but it's not present in the same extent in Europe. The only big thing in Europe is that governments, it's not the private sector, it's the public sector, which is the big beneficiary of all that additional money in Europe. And by that, they don't reform. That's the moral hazard issue. And all these measures, you should know them, and we should be discussing them. Is it okay that credit has been expanded that much more than real growth? It's always the same. When the crisis has come, we should have known that. We should have seen this. We're seeing it. All these imbalances. I wrote a report of 50 pages on all the imbalances of this monetary policy. And then I hear politicians and also central bankers in Belgium saying, oh, there are hardly real side effects and issues, imbalances created. How come I can easily fill a report with 50 pages of imbalances as when this is not existing? Look at what's happening with startups, real estate. If the money is not really flowing to the businesses, that's the big issue between the real and the financial economy. Well, it's the main channel is real estate. And real estate, well, everybody's happy, prices are rising. Our young people have to bring up all and borrow to the tilt to pay this real estate, which is just a reflection of easy money. How fair is that? Isn't that a big distortion to our economy? And so I like to introduce a very important concept created or spread by Claudio Borio from the Bank of International Settlements, which is really fundamental to our situation. It's excess elasticity. Our system has broken down. We are sitting in the car and we are still shifting gears, but there is no connection with our operations and the car anymore. And that's about the excess elasticity. It means central banks, they officially are about stimulating the economy and then preventing it from heating up. But the problem is that financial bubbles are created, and before the economy is really moving ahead again, the bubble is already there. If you could stimulate the economy without inflating a big bubble, well, then the instrument is still working. But before you can have an effective policy, there are huge imbalances and bubbles being created. So we cannot put a brake anymore on excess credit creation before imbalances have developed. And that's a huge problem, and we have to ask ourselves, why come? How come the only big result of monetary policy these days is creating bubbles? Haven't we pushed things over the limit? That's what you're seeing in the markets and in reality, that the bubbles are there before the economy is really moving on. And of course, this has huge impacts for financial institutions. They are searching for yield. And the investable assets, the universe of the investable assets is not enough. The central banks are buying up that much stuff themselves. And be aware, there is still others in the world who are pushing even further. The Bank of Japan is buying the stock market. How big a sane market economy is that? The stock market, how do we interpret that? What's moving the stock market? Oh, it's the central bank. It's buying the stuff. Yeah. Is that still a functioning market economy? And the impact, look at Japan. Well, then there is the three arrows, but the one arrow which is only functioning in Japan is printing the money. It's creating trouble for Japanese banks. And everybody has to ask it themselves, what would happen if interest rates would go up to normal levels? 4%, 6%. What would our world look like at interest rates of 6%? Well, we can imperfectly but try to measure the impact of 1% increase. Well, you see the estimates over here. So it's about risk management policy. And I don't see any risk managers anymore in the policy room. Insurers are impacted too. They are very exposed to sovereign debt. And what's the real value of sovereign debt? Well, we have measurements of the overvaluations of sovereign debt. And you see that it's, of course, there is a variation across countries, but most Eurozone countries have huge overvalued sovereign debt. And then you, in fact, we call that financial repression. We instruct our insurers to invest in that. So we as a government are making it compulsory to invest in stuff we are ourselves overvaluating. That's where we have come end up with. The insurers are very worried about that. Look at what happened with big insurers in 2016. They are having every year more problems, and it's even threatening the essence of their business model. If you really, but that's a theoretical exercise nobody dares to publish, you really would make the exercise of what would happen with insurers if interest rates would stay to the levels of today, the reality would be that there wouldn't be an industry anymore. It's really the death of the business model. But of course, everybody then says, okay, it will not continue forever. It will be only temporary thing. But we have seen the words of Mario Draghi, close to below, but close to 2% in 1.7% in 2018. Is that then, or 2019, is that close? No, that's not sufficient to reverse course. So yes, and that's a real important thing. It's a bit technical, but insurers, we depend on insurers because they make our lives easier, because they can shift over time. They have a time machine. And how do they do that? They use the different maturities of interest rates to invest in assets, and then they make promises to you. They make promises to you about your pension, in 20, 30 years. But what is the real value of these promises if they can't invest in assets anymore, which can match these liabilities? And well, what we're seeing, we have shifted regulations after the financial crisis, partially pushing insurers even more towards government bonds. Well, that's really the captive audience, the captive consumers. We instruct them more and more to invest in these government bonds. And the big issue, which is a bit technical for insurers, is that they have assets and they have liabilities. And they have liabilities on a very long horizon, think about your pension in 30 years' time, and they have to find assets to invest in which can match that. And they can't. And that's the mismatch, what we call the duration gap. And it's very important to know that there are limits how far we can push this duration gap. And it's a big issue, and it's also something which can explain a lot about the streetwiseness of people about what central banks doing. If you would be looking at the countries where the duration gap is the biggest, often these are the countries where people are most skeptical about what central banks are doing. Because they know and they feel much easier than others that it's creating huge problems. Look at the position of Germany, Austria, the Netherlands. The duration gap between the duration gap in these countries is the biggest, and that's where people are most critical about what central banks are doing in the world. The profitability of insurers is in trouble. Their solvency is in problem. We can make simulations about what would happen with the solvency of insurers if interest rates are low or are getting even lower. Well, there are really big issues with solvency for a lot of insurers, certainly when it is with us for longer than, and again, we are already a few years on, and people said, yeah, it's only temporarily, we will be talking about the exit very soon. There are very few people talking about the exit today. And so, yeah, having responsibility is thinking about risk. And scenarios of stress, I can't foresee the future. But it's quite, what I can do is look at what kind of hypotheses market actors are using today in their business models. And they are still using business models who are telling them interest rates will go up very soon and it's only a very temporary problem. Well, what we are seeing is again and again that reality is bypassing the expectations, that the interest rates hypothesis used by a lot of market participants are still too much about wishful thinking, because that many financial institutions would be in deep trouble if this reality would keep persisting. And everybody knows human beings are like that. If the result of low interest rates for many more years is disastrous, then people don't take account of that possibility. And a real risk manager is just doing that. Imagining what would the world be in our business model be if it would be continuing for longer than all the rest is imagining. Read the reports about financial stability of the IMF. A few years ago, it was all about banks. It's now more and more about insurers. And a few years ago, the big dogma or mantra was systemic risks are only problems for banks. Insurers, there is no problems of cascades or dominoes. Now the IMF starts talking about, well, no, we have looked at it a bit closer. And if insurers get into trouble, it can create a systemic risk for society. And and let's face it, and let's do something about it. What would happen with shocks to, if shocks to asset prices are there? And of course, insurers adapt. But one of the big things we have to be very cautious about is another concept I want to introduce. Remember for your exam, the one was excess elasticity, and the second is evergreening. It's about the temptation and the reality that, well, the reality is that so problematic that you are not willing to face reality, and you hide the problem. And that's what's being done on a more massive scale every day. A lot of financial institutions are hiding their problems, and they're rolling over non-performing loans. So their bad assets, which in a normal economic condition, they would have noted down in their bookkeeping bad assets valued at only 40% or written down completely, they are not doing that to the same extent anymore. They are evergreening. They are pushing the problems to the future. The future will solve them, these problems. So, and that's, it's blocking the renewal of the economy. When a lot of people are discussing what is the real issue in our economy today, well, companies are not investing. The renewal of the economy is being blocked. And bubbles are over everywhere. And unsustainable business models are continuing. That's what we saw in Japan, the zombie economy of Japan. And that's something which, and economists, of course, will disagree on that. But then let's debate that publicly. Don't pretend as if the only right economists are the ones who say, oh, no big deal, and it's all a big exaggeration. No, the big difference between economists, I always claim, is there are short economists and there are long economists. No disrespect, you know, Keynes said in the long run we're all dead. So no matter what the long run will be, we will only focus on the short run. Now, there was a context where Keynes has said that, but a lot of economists are very short-termish. And of course, if the media is always interviewing bankers about central banking, Mario Draghi decided this. What is our big specialist in our country saying about that? And it's a banker. Well, he will tell you what's in it for the banks. But we as citizens have to discuss what is in it for us as citizens and the general interest. And be aware that there will always be a big difference, my student in the room knows this, I always stress that, between short-term and the long-term impact of things. And the long-term, of course, some people stress, look more at the long-term than others, but everybody agrees that there is something which is beyond just managing the business cycle in the short run. We also have to mind about the incentives for growth potential in the long run. And if you look at centuries, we published that itinerary book about the Enlightenment, and I take a position about beyond centuries. How come we have grown prosperous over centuries? It's because of innovation and creative destruction. And if our monetary policy today is really blocking this creative destruction, then we will have a big issue in the long run. Look at Japan. We soon need to send some European parliamentarians to Japan to look how the world looks in this kind of environment where interest rates are low for long times. And in 2008, everybody realized we can't go on like this. The debt has grown too high. Well, let's look and take the analysis. At what point, 10 years almost after the crisis, where have we been? Have we managed to deleverage a lot? Oh. And how come is 2 lakhs money supply part to blame that we are? And everybody can disagree on about the speed of the deleveraging, but some progress should be kept, because otherwise, then we didn't learn a lesson. Oh, we had learned a big lesson. We can't, if something is unsustainable, it will not be sustained. If something can't go on forever, it will not, it will stop. The law of Stein. No, apparently we didn't learn this lesson because we didn't really start the big deleveraging a lot. And that's something which is quite technical, but this is about part of our monetary system. It's about transactions between the national central banks of Europe. And Mario Draghi recently made a big statement on that. If you are exiting the Eurozone, then you will have a problem. If you are in debt with other people. But as long as you keep within the Eurozone, it's just something on paper. There are huge transfers between countries which are hidden for the general public. And that's not democratic. And yes, we are pushing interest rates below zero. And of course, you can't find easily a market, but you can make some measurements to make this analysis. And the central bank, the ECB itself, has made some analysis. For every 100 billion we buy, it's equivalent to a drop in interest rates by X. Well, and so we are. It's not the case that we are already. Some people believe this. Oh, it's behind. We are already adjusting. It's something which you. No, we are still pushing these things over their limit. And it's creating a lot of uncertainty. Look at the forecasts we are being ma we are which are being made. The big thing about the forecast is not anymore the forecast itself, but a huge area of uncertainty around the forecast. And is this something which is a bigger problem in Europe? Yes. We have measurements of the policy uncertainty, and the right hindsight shows that there is a huge issue, much more in Europe than in other places in the world, about policy uncertainty. Well, then you shouldn't be surprised that people don't invest if there is that much uncertainty. And where does that uncertainty come from? Certain school of economics calls this, we are entering policies out of the corridor. And you, we, the most economists which are in the debate in the media are always the model economists. They use model-based assessments. But the big point about all the different view on economics is, yes, but there is a problem with the calibration of these models. We have entered uncharted water. The correlations, the estimates which have been used until now, they are not valid anymore out of the corridor. We are and but still people are pretending, and that's the big problem in democracy, when there is somebody like Mario Draghi before the European Parliament. And 3/4 of the European parliaments, they don't ask questions, critical questions, they applaud. Well, it's not the task of a politician or of parliaments to applaud. It's their business to ask critical questions. So, is the world stable? No, we just created a lot of money, and things look stable, because the only horizon we see is water, but everything is hidden below the water. And it's the same thing with the creation of the euro. From the creation from 99, the interest rate differences between countries disappeared. And I was working at a Belgian bank, ING, and I said, this is not. The market is manic depressive. The market is ma manic. The credibility, the creditworthiness of Italy is still a big different thing than the creditworthiness of the Netherlands. But the markets are pricing them as if they are the same. Well, it was because too much reliance on the miracles of central banking. And the market was pricing everything as if there will be bailouts. The no bailout clause was a piece of theory. And in fact, politicians demonstrated that the market was right. The no bailout clause, which was the foundation of all our monetary experiment, was a fiction. The IMF, and again, read the financial stability reports of the IMF, they are calling these times very worrisome to the extent of the stability issues. If you look at their mapping of stability risks, we are at the highest point since 2008. Think about that. Thank you.